The Buddha exalted the venerable Sariputta as the foremost of all monks. He was the foremost in wisdom and was hailed as an exemplary monk whose example should be followed. As such, there was a particular monk who wished to be of service to the elder Sariputta. This monk helped fold Sariputta's robes, sweep his guti, prepare his bowl for alms rounds, and offer massages to help alleviate the body's ailments. The monk did all this with humility and respect. The monk knew of Sariputta's vast knowledge and wished to be close to the elder so that he could absorb some of that knowledge in order to better himself. After the Vasa, which are 3-month periods also known as the rains retreat, where monks are not allowed to leave the temple ground during the rainy season, the venerable Sariputta, with permission from the Buddha, went on a journey to the south of Magadha. The helpful monk, being from the south of Magadha, offered to accompany the elder Sariputta as a guide and a traveling companion. At the beginning of the journey, the helpful monk was patient and led the way. However, since the monk knew the path and the venerable Sariputta did not, the monk began to feel superior to the elder. After they crossed into Magadha, the monk began to change. This feeling of superiority led the monk to feeling annoyed and frustrated at the elder. When the elder asked for a break or had a suggestion, the usually patient and subservient monk would become agitated. The monk would say,
"Look, if you walk any slower, we'll be stuck in the forest all night. Just do as I tell you and stop making suggestions. I know the way and you don't. We're almost there. We can take a break later."
The elder observed this change in behavior. Being an arahan, the elder was in full control of his emotions and thoughts. The venerable Sariputta stopped asking questions, making suggestions, or interacting with the monk. He just continued on the journey silently. In Magadha, the venerable Sariputta was well received by the townsfolk and gave a sermon which helped many people. The venerable Sariputta observed that the monk who traveled with him still had a sour demeanor and was acting haughty and disrespectful. The venerable Sariputta expressed no reaction to the monk's attitude. The elder understood the laws of karma and knew that whatever one does, they get the result of that action. The elder merely noted this change in behavior as part of this monk's personality. When they got to the resting quarters, the elder Sariputta pointed out that there were ropes that needed to be folded. The monk, who was usually eager to serve, said,
"They are your robes. You fold them."
The elder Sariputta merely observed this behavior in silence. On the journey back, the monk was still agitated and haughty. The venerable Sariputta withstood the snide comments and remarks in silence, merely observing and noting the behavior of this monk. The venerable elder did not feel compelled to conquer, change, or instruct this monk. The monk had not asked for help, nor was he open to receiving it. In addition, the monk was merely showing his true nature. However, once they got close to the temple, the monk's demeanor reverted back. He offered to carry the elder's bowl and began acting as respectfully and humbly as before the journey. The elder observed this reversion in behavior in silence. When back inside the temple grounds, the monk was humble, eager, and respectful to the elder Sariputta. He acted as if nothing changed and eagerly accepted teachings, rebukes, and admonishments. The Venerable Sariputta did not scold him, rebuke him, or mention his actions during the journey. At an appropriate time, the elder Sariputta asked the Buddha, "My Lord, a resident here serves me as a loyal attendant in one place, and in another place, he is so proud and haughty that a mere word sparks a quarrel." "Sariputta, this is not the first time that this monk has acted in this way. In the past as well, he acted as a loyal attendant in one place, and in another place, he was so proud and haughty that a mere word sparked quarrels." And upon the request of the elder, the Buddha told the story of the past. A long time ago, when Brahmadatta was reigning in Benares, the Bodhisattva was born as a Brahmin and befriended another Brahmin of the same stature. His friend was also an old man. However, he had a young wife who gave him a son and heir. The Bodhisattva's friend was concerned that as soon as he died, his wife, who was young and beautiful, would just marry another man and spend all his money, leaving nothing for his son. He decided that the best course of action would be to bury the money safely in the ground. The Brahmin, in the company of a loyal household slave named Nanda, set off with all the riches and headed towards a deep forest. The Brahmin had Nanda dig a gaping hole deep in the forest. There, he had Nanda bury all the gold and riches. He then told Nanda,
"Nanda, my good and loyal servant, serve my son well as you have served me. Do not tell the mistress of the house where the riches are buried. Wait until my son asks for his wealth, then bring him here and give it to him."
Not too long after this, the Brahmin died. After many years, the Brahmin's son grew up. His wife did not remarry as he assumed she would. She said to her son, "My son, your father once took Nanda into the woods with all his riches, and when they came back, the riches were not with them. Most likely he buried his wealth in the woods, in fear of my remarrying and not taking care of you. You are now of age to lead the household. Go to Nanda and get the money back and look after our family." So one day, the son said to Nanda,
"Nanda, is there any treasure that my father had buried?"
"Yes, my lord."
"Where is it buried?"
"In the forest, my lord."
"Well then, let us go and get it."
And so Nanda and the Brahmin's son went off towards the forest with tools and supplies. However, when they got to the forest, Nanda did not tell the Brahmin's son where the gold and riches were buried. Instead, Nanda became haughty because he reflected that he was the only one who knew where the riches were buried. When the Brahmin's son asked where the money was buried, Nanda said,
"Oh, you want to know where the money I buried is? You mean the money your father wanted to hide from your slave wench of a mother? You mean the money that you never had to earn?"
The Brahmin's son was shocked at this sudden change in Nanda and could not understand what caused it. Nanda had never spoken to him like this in his entire life. He pretended to have not heard the disrespect, He did not want to risk losing the buried riches, since Nanda was the only one who knew where it was buried. So the Brahmin's son decided to just return home. When they got home, Nanda went back to being respectful and helpful again. After a few days, the Brahmin's son brought Nanda back to the forest, and when they got to a certain depth, Nanda again changed his behavior and berated the Brahmin's son. This happened a few times. On the final time, the Brahmin's son reflected.
Every time I ask him to bring me to the money, he is always eager and willing. However, no sooner do we get there, he begins to abuse me. I do not see the reason behind this. Perhaps I should ask my father's best friend for advice.
And so the Brahmin's son went to visit the Bodhisat and told him the entire story. The Bodhisat said,
"It is obvious to me, young master, that the spot where Nanda berates and abuses you is where your father's money is buried. Therefore, the next time he starts berating you, say to him, 'Slave, to whom are you talking?' Take the spade and shovel from his hand and begin digging where he stands. Then make the slave carry the treasure home for you."
And so the Brahmin's son set off once again with Nanda to the forest to receive his family's riches. Once again, when they reached a particular spot, Nanda began to berate the Brahmin's son. However, this time, the Brahmin's son did as the Bodhisat advised. He dug deep and eventually found his family's treasure. The Brahmin's son gathered all the riches into the wagon and had Nanda lug it all back home. When back at the house, Nanda went back to his respectful self. He no longer had the secret that led to his haughtiness and lived humbly, with respect to his station. The Brahmin's son looked after his family and heeded the Bodhisat's counsel, spending his life giving charity and other good works. At the end of the Jataka story, the Buddha said, "In the past, the flip-flopping monk was of this disposition. Sariputta's flip-flopping monk was the Nanda of those days, and I myself was the Brahmin's best friend."
What did you learn from this story? We hope you enjoyed the video. Click like if you did, and click subscribe if you want to see our uploads.